Hello, and welcome to Faithfully Memphis. I am the Reverend Deacon Gerri Endicott, vocational deacon in the Episcopal Diocese of West Tennessee, serving the Church of the Holy Apostles in Collierville. Every Thursday at 8 a.m., this program speaks with interesting people to learn about the role that faith plays in their lives. We are broadcast from WYXR 91.7 FM in Memphis, Tennessee. At this time each week, we learn about the saint of the day, someone who has made a positive impact. On the 20th of this month, we commemorate the life and work of Frederick Douglass. When conducting my research for this segment, I ran across an article published on the Episcopal Cafe website from February 20th, 2016. It was written by Linda Ryan, a mentor, blogger, and resident in the Episcopal Diocese of Arizona. Though written in 2016, her words seem particularly appropriate this year. It also sounds a lot like something a deacon would preach. It's called Speaking to the Soul, Frederick Douglass. And she starts with a quote, "At a time like this, scorching irony, not convincing argument, is needed. Oh, had I the ability and could I reach the nation's ear, I would today pour out a fiery stream of biting ridicule, blasting reproach, withering sarcasm, and stern rebuke. For it is not light that is needed, but fire. It is not the gentle shower, but thunder. We need the storm, the whirlwind, and the earthquake. The feeling of the nation must be quickened. The conscience of the nation must be roused. The propriety of the nation must be startled. The hypocrisy of the nation must be exposed, and its crimes against God and man must be denounced." Frederick Douglass, from The Hypocrisy of American Slavery, in a speech given on July 4th, 1852. February is noted for Groundhog Day, Valentine's Day, President's Day, Ash Wednesday, and the beginning of Lent in most years, and various saints' days and famous birthdays. February is also noted as Black History Month, designated by each president since 1976. Prior to the 1976 declaration, however, there was Black History Week, established in 1927 by Carter G. Woodson, a historian, and a group of prominent African Americans. In 1915, that same Carter G. Woodson founded the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, which in 1927 proclaimed the first Black History Week to be held on the second week in February as a tribute to the birthdays of Abraham Lincoln, the Great Emancipator, and Frederick Douglass, proclaimed the greatest African American leader of the 19th century. Born a slave around 1818, his master's wife taught him the alphabet, and Douglass took off from there. In about his 20th year, Douglass escaped from slavery and went to Massachusetts, where he attended a Black church and also abolitionist meetings. He became a producer of abolitionist newspapers, several autobiographies, and an early advocate of school desegregation. He became an advocate of women's rights in 1848. At the first convention for women's rights, he was in the minority of supporters, but rose to speak eloquently, including a statement that he, as a Black man, could not accept the right to vote if women were denied the same right. He continued to speak for equal rights all throughout his life. On July 4, 1852, Douglas gave the speech from which the quotation above was taken. These are words of an impassioned man who spoke as a prophetic witness to the sins of a country who proclaimed itself Christian but failed to follow the rules Jesus himself set down, as well as God's words from Ararat to Moses. Douglas had been a churchgoer and had, at least at one point during his slavery, taught Sunday school at the African American church. Throughout his life, his passion was fostered by his faith, and the zeal produced a style of oratory which is still present today. If you listen to the passionate oratory of our presiding bishop, Michael Curry, you will hear echoes of Frederick Douglass and others. It's a good thing to hear, although different from what most of us today hear in the pulpit and other places. Listen to those around you and those you hear and see via long-distance media. Are they cultivating fear, or are they promoting freedom, equality, and justice? Where do you hear truth? Where do you hear exaggeration? Where do you hear inflammatory and derogatory remarks? What do we do with the information we hear? And then, what do we do with the actions we see resulting from that information? Douglas went on to have an illustrious career as a newspaper editor, certified lay preacher, an advisor to Abraham Lincoln, marshal and recorder of deeds in Washington, D.C., a diplomat to Santo Domingo, and minister to Haiti. He backed away from those he felt were too rigid or radical in the abolitionist movement, but he never lost sight of his original goal, namely to see the African Americans as free and equal people. We need a few more Frederick Douglasses among us. Actually, we have some, but their voices are sometimes drowned out. They need to be heard, and we need to hear them. But do we have the courage to try to dial down the noise and ramp up the things that beg to be heard? Heaven knows we could use a few Douglasses to stand up at rallies where the crowd may be hostile and speak the truth that needs to be spoken. If we hear someone offering us a message with honesty, transparency, and passion, perhaps it is something to pay attention to. Furthermore, if the message offers us ways to do something to benefit everyone, not just a special group of privileged people, we may have found a prophetic witness for this age. Keep looking and listening. They're there. For our first hymn this morning, I chose a beautiful a cappella version of Lift Every Voice and Sing. It speaks to Douglass's life and work for the freedom and equality of all of God's beloved children. You're listening to Faithfully Memphis on WYXR 91.7 FM. We'll be right back.
Lift every voice and sing, till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Rejoicing, rise
high as the listening skies.
Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us, facing the rising sun of our new day.
us march on till victory.
Welcome back to Faithfully Memphis on WYXR 91.7 FM. The world is full of ordinary people living ordinary lives, doing extraordinary things by virtue of their faith. My guest today is Tom Carpenter, the Director of Adult Formation at Church of the Holy Apostles, where I serve as vocational deacon. So, Tom, tell us a little about yourself, your life, your work, your religious history.
Thank you, Gerri. I was born in Baltimore, Maryland, and I grew up all over the place. St. Louis, Florida, Indiana, but landed here in the Memphis area in 1976, and I attended Germantown High School, graduating in 1980. After that, I went to the University of Tennessee in Knoxville, and got a business degree in transportation and logistics. That has nothing to do with what I'm doing today. I came back here to Memphis to start my first job, and I had a 30-year career in corporate logistics management. I finished my career here in Memphis with International Paper after living in both Atlanta, Georgia, and South Carolina for about 20 years. During my professional life, I traveled extensively, including places like Japan, Singapore, China, the UK, France, Germany, Poland, and Brazil, and of course, Canada. But coming home to Memphis has brought me back full circle. My church background is also a bit of a winding road. I was born and raised in the United Methodist Church. Until middle school, when our family stopped attending our regular church services. In college, while in Knoxville, I discovered that I could sing, and I joined a church choir just off campus in downtown Knoxville. I have been singing in church choirs ever since, and so that's a little over 40 years. In Atlanta, I met my wife, and we married in my church, a Methodist church. But she was raised in the Catholic Church, and my church never really felt like our church. So, when we moved to South Carolina, we decided to attend and become members of the Episcopal Church. We both felt very much at home there. Of course, when we moved back to the Memphis area, we looked for an Episcopal church to join and were blessed to find Holy Apostles in Collierville, which at the time was still a very small congregation, around 50 people or so. Our parish has grown since then, with average Sunday attendance, prior to the pandemic, of course, to around 200 to 250 people, with perhaps twice that many on the membership rolls.
So I met Tom, I think we decided it was about 6 years ago, when we were both participating in a focus group for those who were sensing God moving in their lives in a significant and perhaps life-changing way. As God doesn't send engraved invitations, I didn't get anything in the mail that said, "Gerri, the honor of your presence is requested at your ordination." Groups such as this assist in discerning where the Holy Spirit may be leading. At the end of the better part of a year of assignments, meetings, challenges, deep thought, and hard work, Tom and I parted ways to continue on our paths. Last year, I found myself, now ordained, assigned to the Church of the Holy Apostles, where Tom had been busy exercising the ministry that emerged from his discernment. So we have come full circle to the same place in different capacities. So tell us about the journey that led you to and through discernment and took you to your current roles in the church.
I had served as senior warden of my parish in South Carolina. Senior warden is kind of like the chairman of the administrative board for the Episcopal Church local parish. And so I had served as senior warden of my local parish in South Carolina before we moved back here. And again, I served as senior warden here at Holy Apostles. The point being, I learned how the church operates, both pastorally and theologically, but also administratively. Then Bishop Don Johnson, before Bishop Phoebe, invited me to serve on the Commission on Ministries, which oversees candidates moving through the process of discernment for holy orders, either the diaconate like you, or priesthood. It was there, on that committee, that the real seeds were being planted as I myself began to hear more clearly God's call for me to enter more fully into the ministry. So I sat down with my pastor and priest, Father John Leach, and I began that conversation. We talked on and off for about 6 months until he decided to form a parish discernment committee to help me hear and understand what God might be calling me to do in ministry. Of course, having experienced a relatively successful business career, I was under the impression that God was calling me into the priesthood. The point being, I was used to being the boss and managing important business matters, and so moving into a leadership position with overall responsibility for a congregation, worship, budgets, employees, pastoral care, etc., seemed to me like the next logical step. From start to finish, my discernment process lasted about 5 years, with two parish committees, the bishop, his assistant, who we call the canon to the ordinary, and a couple of licensed psychologists and a spiritual director. I finally discovered, with the help of my loving wife, that in fact God was not calling me into ordained ministry, but rather into a teaching ministry. So I enrolled at Memphis Theological Seminary and began my coursework on a Master's of Arts in Religion in the fall of 2017. I graduated in the spring of 2019, and what I found, Gerri, was that MTS was exactly where I needed to be. The classes and the faculty were amazing, but even more so, the students were just remarkable. After my graduation from Memphis Theological Seminary, my pastor and priest, Father John Leach, invited me to join the staff at Holy Apostles as the Director of Adult Formation and Christian Education. In this role, I have overall responsibility for the development and delivery of adult Christian education programs at the church. I currently teach 4 classes each week in adult Bible study, and I also present a different topic each Sunday morning in our adult education hour. In those weekly programs, we actually touch about 50 to 60 people in Christian education and formation opportunities.
It's funny how the Holy Spirit a lot of times leads us where we didn't think we wanted to go. And in the end, who's right?
Yes, absolutely.
So, how does your faith and ministry within the church inform your life in the community and at home?
You know, if I were to answer that question in one word, it would be vocation. My understanding of what we are called to do and to be in this world as baptized Christians, whether it's in the Episcopal Church or any other denomination, is to discern and then live into our vocational calling, which can take many, many forms. And it doesn't necessarily mean that it's one particular vocational calling for the rest of our life. We can move through different vocational opportunities as we learn more and more about our own individual ministries, but also our collective ministries in the church. And so for me, that understanding has really changed the way that I view and understanding, the way that I understand my my place in Christianity as a whole. And when I say that, what I'm talking about is that my understanding of Christianity has been radically altered away from an understanding of individual salvation towards vocation and vocation in ministry, which then in turn becomes my experience of salvation in the world. To serve Christ in others, and your remarks in terms of what Frederick Douglass was calling all of us into, was that understanding to serve others is in fact what Christ has called us to do in our lives. And so that has taken a lot of different forms over the last several years, up to and including my current experience at Holy Apostles as the Director of Adult Formation.
So in our Episcopal tradition, as part of the promises we make at our baptism, we're asked a series of questions. To me, and I think to Tom, the last three in particular tell us exactly what we are to do in order to live a life in Christ. And those questions we answer, and our response is always, I will with God's help, are, will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ? Will you serve and seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself? And will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being? These promises lead us into places where people are in need, where there is hunger both in body and in spirit. We are called to be where others may not want to go, and we are called to find God there. So, Tom, how do you live out those baptismal promises in your daily life? And what are the challenges in doing so when located in an area of the county that is not known for great need? When you think Collierville, you don't think poverty and hunger. It's a pretty high-priced area. So how do you deal with those promises while being involved in ministry in an area where need is definitely there, but it's not quite so apparent?
It's a really thoughtful question, because I think that the general impression of Collierville as an overall community, and by and large, there's great truth in that, is that it is a fairly affluent community. But even where there is comfort and affluence, like we see in places like Collierville, Tennessee, there's also great need. There is hurting, there's pain, there's suffering going on in people's lives. And quite frankly, there's probably a little bit more poverty and economic distress in the community than people realize as well. But also, the part of my responsibility as a minister within the staff at Holy Apostles is to make sure that our parish is not living in an isolated way within the Collierville community alone. We take time and energy to make sure that as a parish, we are ministering both locally in and around Collierville, but also in the greater Memphis area. And probably the best example of that over the last decade has been a ministry that we have had that is in partnership with the Emanuel Center in the neighborhood that used to be where Foot Homes apartments used to be. The Emanuel Center and Holy Apostles got together over 10 years ago and recognized that there was an opportunity for both residents of Collierville and parishioners at Holy Apostles to spend time with and mentor students that were involved at the Emanuel Center who were committed to and trying to do as much and as well as they could within school, but they might not have necessarily had the necessary support structures around them to do that. And so we started this ministry that we called Helping Hands. And over that time, we've ministered to well over a dozen students, carrying them really through sixth grade all the way to their high school graduation. And in some cases, moving them through the college application process and beyond to attending college to enable and help those students really achieve their full potential. Now, unfortunately, again, because of the pandemic, some of that has had to be suspended temporarily. But as soon as we are able, we are looking forward to revitalizing that ministry and even expanding that ministry locally to both Collierville and Germantown schools, as well as to Memphis inner city schools as well. And so that really speaks to the fact that we see our ministry at Holy Apostles both in terms of ministering to people locally where their needs are and meeting them where they are, but also making sure that residents and parishioners in our parish also know that they are part of a larger community, which includes Memphis as well.
Right. Yes, there's and part of my work at Holy Apostles, which I've only just begun in these pandemic times, is to identify areas of need where they may not be very apparent. We sometimes forget that there are probably people in our pews who we do not know have needs.
And unfortunately, in a parish like you might find in a place like Collierville or Germantown, and it certainly happens in other places as well, but sometimes we don't find out that need is real until it's too late, whether it be the passing of a friend or a suicide of a neighbor. Sometimes in communities that are better off economically, people are just doing a better job of hiding some of that pain in their lives. And we have a responsibility to be there and to minister to those people just as much as anyone else.
Exactly. So what causes and concerns speak to you? What are the things that get you to thinking about a difference you can make in the world, or where you should be or the church should be that it might not necessarily be all the time?
Yeah, that's a good and challenging question. One of the themes that we continue to put in front of our participants in our adult formation and Christian education programs is that Jesus was often about crossing boundaries. Jesus was often about speaking to or healing the person that Jesus wasn't supposed to be talking to or wasn't supposed to be healing in that particular instance, at least according to the conventional understanding of culture in the first century. And so crossing boundaries and understanding where we are being called, in fact, to cross those boundaries has caused me to understand my ministry, I guess, through three particular lenses. The first is through social ministry, and that leads me into ministry and causes around racial justice, as you mentioned before. But all of those things are ultimately connected to economic justice. And so those three things in terms of social justice, racial justice, and finally economic justice and issues of economic equality across our communities are really the three things that form and shape and feed my ministry in terms of all of the things that we try and teach, all the things that we try and give to our folks. Because ultimately, Christian education is about what we call adult formation. The things that we do in teaching and learning should be shaping and forming us as members of the church to then take that to be changed, to be transformed, and then to share that with others in the world.
Yeah, I see a key today, particularly in the things going on in our country, the pandemic, politically. That's a real challenge. Our people, and I'm going to include myself in that. I have grown a lot this past year. We sometimes don't realize the biases and prejudices that are deep down inside, and we don't like to admit them. And so it becomes a little difficult when you're dealing with adults who may not even realize they're very set in their ways, but they are. And yet we are called to be able to be transformed by the gospel.
You're exactly right. And one of the things that I learned throughout the discernment process, but also through my educational process at MTS, is in many cases, the church has become institutionalized to the point where the church has maybe lost its understanding of its role in the world, or maybe it's not necessarily reinforcing the things that we need to learn and to hear. And so we don't necessarily get to wag our finger and yell at people around those things. Really, what we're called to do is to speak and to give voice to those things, but to do those things in such a way that we meet people where we find them, and then gently encourage them to think outside of their current paradigm or think outside their current box and begin to question the assumptions that may be boxing them in to a certain way of thinking. And that's needed in our community. Collierville, as much as any place on the map, people need to be willing to think outside of their current experience and their current worldview to really understand that the rest of the world doesn't necessarily look and behave that way. And there are needs that are calling us all to step into those opportunities. And that really, to me, is probably the most exciting component of my ministry today.
Yeah. I think that the church, or at least portions of the church, and I see it within the Episcopal Church, we're kind of heading into a new way of being. Maybe it's a little more like first century Christianity, and that is not a bad thing. So I think there are plenty of opportunities these days for that growth into what we call God's kingdom, where everyone is equal, and that ideal that, gosh, we may not get it in my lifetime, but maybe in my children's and my grandson's lifetime, we won't have to have these types of conversations.
Yeah, I hope it won't take that long, but I think there's a lot of truth in what you're saying.
And that's our job, is to speak that truth.
Amen.
Amen. Well, Tom, I think our time is about up. Thank you very much for joining me today.
Thank you for the invitation, Gerri.
On this adventure for both of us.
Absolutely.
I hope we have... Tom and I have given some of our listeners something to think about. You're listening to Faithfully Memphis on WYXR 91.7 FM. We'll be right back.
Thou my grateful
Welcome back to Faithfully Memphis on WYXR 91.7 FM. At this point, each week's host normally answers questions that are frequently posed to them. I'm not certain this has anything to do with my being a deacon, or if it's simply that those who know me are sure I will have an answer ready. What I hear more often than anything is some version of, "What are you reading?" or "Do you have any suggestions?" First, I have been known to read just about anything, including the encyclopedia. Remember when those were actual books? I do enjoy the occasional novel, but I find theology, history, and memoirs capture my attention more than anything else. I read about other places and times and people who are not like me, although I generally find we are more alike than different. Several months ago, I began an intentional study of the history of race in our country. I have been enlightened, disturbed, and moved by the works of James Baldwin, The Color of Law by Richard Rothstein, How to Be an Anti-Racist by Ibram Kendi, which we also read for our Holy Apostles Book Club, and many more. Currently in the works are The Warmth of Other Suns by Isabel Wilkerson and Shelby Foote's comprehensive and exhausting work, The Civil War, A Narrative, all 2,968 pages of it, with about 1,000 left to go. Perhaps the most difficult question posed in my search for one to stump the deacon was this: other than the Bible, tell us about the most theologically in-depth book you have read. That one was from our friend Tom here. So I thought, and I went to my bookshelves and looked at all the books I have read, trying to isolate one out of the scores of theological works of which I have read at least parts. It then occurred to me to turn to the shelves set aside for novels. You know, those books I only read occasionally. I knew right where it was. It's Jaber Crow by Wendell Berry. Subtitled, The Life Story of Jaber Crow, Barber of the Port William Membership, as written by himself. It is the fictional autobiography of a simple man in a rural Kentucky setting. It's a book for sitting in the quiet and reading slowly and intently. An entire life lived in some 363 pages of beautiful prose, with direct theology thrown in sparingly, but full of the beauty of God's creation and created beings and the mysteries of life. Near the end, Jaber ponders why, with all the troubles of the world, Christ has not yet returned in power and glory. There have been plenty of good opportunities. He comes to this conclusion. And so, I thought, he must forbear to reveal his power and glory by presenting himself as himself, and must be present only in the ordinary miracle of the existence of his creatures. Those who wish to see him must see him in the poor, the hungry, the hurt, the wordless creatures, the groaning and travailing, beautiful world. And that, Tom, is why I'm a deacon. You're listening to Faithfully Memphis on WYXR 91.7 FM. We'll be right back.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, that day when freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransomed soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Thank you for joining us this morning. If you'd like to learn more about the Church of the Holy Apostles in Collierville, visit our website at holyapostlestn.net. You will find service times, a link to recordings of past services, and information about the various ministries offered. The Episcopal Cafe is located at episcopalcafe.com. The Episcopal Diocese of West Tennessee may be found on Facebook, Instagram, and at episwtn.org. Past episodes of Faithfully Memphis may be heard on Spotify or wherever you listen to podcasts. Please like and subscribe. This is Deacon Gerri Endicott for Faithfully Memphis. Until next time, stay safe and stay positive.